motor car can seem a hostile, belligerent beast. Savage and menacing, it wears a heartless grin and steely eyes. Designed to bring fear to the fast lane and terror to the turnpike, even the names threaten. Jaguar, Panther, Cougar, Rapier, Scimitar. Are we to drive them or do battle in them? And yet, there's one car which doesn't intimidate. One car that doesn't have an attitude. Say hello to a car of such heartwarming chumminess that it's the world's matiest four-wheeler.
The Fiat 500 is one of those creations that if it didn't already exist, we'd have to invent it. It's got a smiling face, a cartoon-like friendliness. If eight-year-olds could drive, this is what they'd choose. The tiny Fiat doesn't carry any of that tiresome machismo baggage, all that powered aggression and sexuality. What you see is what you get. It's the smallest car with the biggest personality.
Not so much a car, but a toy for children of all ages. The sort of thing you want to pick up between forefinger and thumb and scoot along the top of a table.
There is something about them that she just goes mad about. I don't think you'd ever find another person like her because she literally drives you mad. I mean, Fiat 500s is all you hear, breakfast, dinner and tea.
It's got a life. It's not just a piece of metal. It's sort of got a little personality all of its own. It hums when I go on a long drive. When it warms up, it's got a nice tone. And it's happy, yeah. I sound an absolute nutcase, but I am quite nutty about it, really.
I just find them aesthetically beautiful. The line, the curvature, the size, the compactness.
They have everything that a proper car should have, but it's in miniature throughout, from the switches that you put on, the lights, I mean, those are tiny, everything is tiny. Even these little windows here, I mean, it's just perfect. They're perfect little cars.
The story of this perfect little car begins with one man, Dante Giacosa, a design genius who in 1936 gave Italy minuscule mobility with the Topolino, or Little Mouse. He brought loose-change motoring to an entire nation and created an Italian cult of tiny cars, which has lasted to the present day. But his finest hour came in 1957, when the diminutive 500 charmed the whole of Italy. It really was love at first sight.
Hearts will play tippy-tippy-tay, tippy-tippy-tay, like a guitarandella.
At only 400 quid, it was Italy's most affordable new car. Despite the escalating Suez crisis, the 500's frugality, 60 miles to the gallon, made it cheaper than walking. It put a generation of Italians on four tiny wheels, and 40 years on, the love affair with Fiat's Bambino is as passionate as ever. In the spiritual home of blood-red Ferraris and blow-dried masculinity, the fut-fut Fiat is a national institution.
Excuse me, but you see, back in old Napoli, that's amore.
I don't know what to say. Is what to say? Liscio.
Maneuverable.
Maneuverable. Yes, it's very maneuverable.
For us, this car is a little Ferrari.
I prefer Jaguar cars for the styling, but for the economicity. We prefer the 500.
This car has its own style. It's an understatement style. It's the style of simplicity.
You can have a very beautiful life driving a 500.
But yes, the Italians would say that.
They're crazed, emotional creatures, passionate about all the wrong things. But we who would lay claim to a level head, we would take one look at the Fiat 500 and say, it's a joke, surely. We would say it's slow, it's cramped, it's hot, it's noisy, it's uncomfortable. As an inanimate object, sure, it's pretty enough, very nice. But as a mode of propulsion, we would say it's hopeless, wouldn't we?
That was the ridiculous, and here's the sublime. The 230-mile-an-hour McLaren F1, the world's most expensive production car. So what would you expect the designers of this motoring masterpiece to drive themselves?
One of the reasons why the Fiat probably is still successful, people still like it, is because it's actually a lot of fun to drive. Small cars like this can be totally wretched, irritating, nasty things. But with these, because they handle so nicely, the steering is so nice, you can actually enjoy driving it, despite the fact you're not going fast. So you get out of it smiling, usually.
When you're designing something like the F1, subconsciously use or draw on what the 500 is good for, the packaging and the general good feeling of the car, the good shape of the car.
While I was working on the design of the Lotus Elan, we didn't know where to put the interior light. And a suggestion that I made, because I had a Fiat 500 at the time, was we should do what Fiat did, which is put the light inside the rear view mirror. And that's where it is on the Elan. An idea we took straight off the 500.
I think a good example of the fact that it's packaged so well is that I'm 6'4", and I can sit in the car with 2 or 3 inches of headroom, and I can actually drive the car without the seat fully back on the stop. It's a brilliant bit of packaging, really.
But even the most ardent admirer of the 500 would have to admit that this is not a fast car. It has all the performance of a stone snail. I tell you what the 0-60 time was. The only problem is it won't do 60, only 50. But we've got time to spare, so let's try it. Go and put the kettle on. Miles an hour. This, of course, is the 500L, L standing not for lethargic, but for luxury. It has a fuel gauge, not that it ever moves, carpets and reclining seats, and, of course, an ashtray, 25 miles an hour. Somebody once achieved 124 miles to the gallon in one of these. He can't have been in a hurry. 40 miles an hour, 45 miles an hour, I hope there aren't any hills. 49 miles an hour, 50 miles an hour, bravissimo! 50 miles an hour in, well, it doesn't matter. But there is one huge advantage that the Fiat 500 does have.
There are times when size does matter, and being neat and petite means that the 500 can reach the parts other cars can't. With a speedometer the size of a pocket watch, a choke lever like a cocktail stick, and a glove box for only one glove, not a centimetre is wasted anywhere. Inside, there are 4 seats that wouldn't look out of place in a doll's house. Up front, a fuel tank no bigger than a jam jar and luggage space for a toothbrush or two. While at the rear lives an air-cooled engine the size of a typewriter. But with such economy of scale, 4-into-1 really does go.
But I can hear the hecklers, and they're saying, you've forgotten all about the Mini. Surely that did it all better. Uh-uh. The 500 is even smaller than the Mini, and it predates it by 2. You'd be a real anorak and tell you that Giacosa had a front-wheel drive transverse engine prototype like the Mini running as early as 1947. So the 500 then stands before you as the first, as the original miracle of automotive packaging.
First time I saw this car, it was sitting in somebody's back garden, literally with a tree growing through it. And it just looked so forlorn that we decided we'd got to have it. So we chop the tree down, put a battery on it, put some petrol in it, got it started, and then actually drove it home. And it's been my car ever since. My husband thinks I'm complete and utter nut. But in one sense, it's his own fault, because he was the first one who pointed this car, these cars out to me. His love is Jaguars, and at one time, that was my love as well. But since I've had this, I'm afraid, as far as I'm concerned, the Jaguars have taken a slight back shelf.
It's just like having a partner. You put up with his bad faults and you put up with his good points, so, you know, you've got to take the rough with the smooth to a certain extent. It's quite funny when I go to the drive-in, because I'm not really the right height to actually say what my order is. And very often when I do say what my order is, they don't hear me.
Can I have a Big Mac and fries, please?
Sorry, I can't hear you. Can you speak up, please?
Can I have a Big Mac and fries, please?
Sorry, I still can't hear you.
And so what I do on occasion is actually open the roof and lean out and actually shout my order right into the microphone.
Can I have a Big Mac and fries, please?
And then obviously I can then drive off and collect my order.
Now, this is where I demonstrate how to drive it. You have to get down into the bottom of the hill, you see. You have to listen to it and change down at the crucial moment, otherwise you lose speed. That's what makes it fun to drive, as you're involved with it. It's not all done by computers.
In 1960, Fiat introduced their Giardiniera, the world's smallest load lugger. And then there was the Gamine, a two-seater convertible for Noddy and Big Ears, based on the 500. But even this isn't the Didi Fiat's wackiest incarnation. 500s used to go racing. A tuning firm called Arbath prized a dizzy 75 miles an hour out of the little series. With engines literally spilling out of the back, these midget racers went round circuits like frenzied clockwork mice.
It's either the world's slowest fast car or the world's fastest slow car. It handles beautifully. It's a good roundabout car. But I can't make any great claims for top speed. It's also limited by its engine characteristics, because I can tell you one quick story. I bought some bits off an Italian, and I asked him how fast his went, and he said, "The car should do about 90 miles an hour. The main bearings, they only do 70.
The differences between the standard car and this car are night and day. The standard car has a 0 to 50 time of 42 seconds, and this one has a 0 to 50 time of 14 seconds. So that, coupled with an increase of approximately 25 mile an hour on top speed, means it's a lot more fun. It's the pursuit of happiness, pleasure, fun, and if that's eccentricity, well, so be it.
And while we're on the subject of eccentricity, imagine you lived in the sun-washed Principality of Monaco. Imagine money was no object. Your choice of car is crucial in projecting the right image. So what would you choose? Of course, you choose the most expensive and exclusive 500, the Jolly.
The car is not for sale and never will be for sale. It's something which will always remain with us. We had many offers. We had many offers written, notes left behind the windscreens. Even on the day when I brought the car, two Dutch gentlemen stopped and asked if the car is for sale. I said, it's not for sale. And they said, well, we offer any price. I said, well, there is no any price.
In Monaco, the big problem is to park the car, because the city is very small and it's very crowded. So they start to push all the car inside of parking lot. So because it's small and because it's very pretty, I can park where I want, and with a nice smile, they don't give me no fine, nothing. So it's a very advantage car.
It's a happy car, and it makes people happy.
But not even the 500 can make everybody happy all of the time.
As a child, my parents had a Fiat 500 estate, and when you'd be going along the road, the car was very slow and very noisy. And when you would go up hills, it would be extremely slow and incredibly noisy. It was so embarrassing to be a child, and when all your friends had really wonderful cars like Zephyrs and really stylish cars, we would consider, and we had this little thing.
Things always seem to happen to it. People move it around, they pick it up and put it somewhere else. I think they can't resist it. I think it's lads, especially if they've been to the pub, they just think it's a laugh. But despite all that, I wouldn't swap the car at all. I mean, it's all these little breakdowns and stories that seem to make it more endearing to you. And it's just part of owning a 500.
I have been pulled over by a police car for speeding. However, I was only cautioned because the policeman couldn't actually believe I could get that fast. With a modern car, you just don't get as much character. They all look the same. Even if you put two 500s together, they look different. They've all got their own individual character. I love that.
And it's not only the cars that have character. In 68, Ted Amos toured 6,000 miles round Europe in 28 days. He left the passenger seat at home and carried his bed with him. We took Ted back in time.
Imagine me, feet there, and head here. Now, you don't go to bed like this. You bend a bit, huh? It became like a little house. And this is why it's the only car, when it blew up and I had to send it to the knacker's yard, it's the only car I've cried about. And I don't particularly like admitting that, but the truth will out. It was something personal to me.
Tears were shed all over the world when in 1975 the last 500s came off the production line after a run of almost 3 million. Its successor, the 126, appeared 3 years earlier, but Fiat continued with the 500, saying, "We didn't have the heart to axe the little fella." And despite such imaginative advertising, the 126 never possessed the same personality. Fiat's newest Cinquecento may have the same spirit, charm and elfin effervescence as that raucous little buzzbox of 57, but we just can't love it in quite the same way. Perhaps the 500 occupies a very special place in our hearts because we know we're looking at a glimpse of the future. Microcars do more than just make us laugh. They're the perfect form of socially responsible urban transport. Our unconditional love of the 500 means that deep down inside, we all know that one day soon, and it's not very far off, all cars will be this big.